All right, YouTube, we got a few charging system issues again on a G1000 Cessna. So let's just take a look at that and what we found, because this one caught me out a little bit, but we got there. All right, now this airplane came in with no charge at all, low volt light and not working. On these G1000 Cessna, in fact, most of the later Cessnas, the field terminals on the alternator are these Mickey Mouse push-on things, and they give some trouble. They actually put this sort of little plastic junky thing on to help hold the spades onto the lugs there, but to be honest, it's just a bit of Mickey Mouse plastic that catches behind here. You really need to take these off. This is the STA and this is the field terminal. This is not used on a lot of these Cessna installations, but the field terminal is important. So you've got to clean that and general check of the crimps and terminals. That say the output and the ground are proper screwed lugs. Most alternators, most aircraft alternators, these are, the field is a screwed lug as well, but on these ones, it ain't, and they do give trouble occasionally. But that was not the case on this one, as we shall see later in the video. All right, now when this aircraft came in, I ran it just to see what was going, and there was no charge whatsoever. And I had a meter on the bus, and I just cycled the alternator master switch. Absolutely nothing. Nichts. Kaput. Not an extra millivolt. Until about the fourth time of closing it, suddenly it all sprung into life. But all was not well. Now, suspecting this switch to be intermittent, which it may or may not be, I replaced the master switch. Ran the airplane again. But let's just have a look at it running. Something is still not right, even with the new master switch. All right, now this is the point where I actually started taking some video, because I thought, well, I mean, I do occasionally just to go back and review what was actually happening, if I think there's still an issue. And okay, put a new master switch on and the system all comes alive. But if you look at the M&E bus, the main emergency bus, on the electrical screen at the bottom there, it's fluctuating more than they normally do. It ought to just, it really, most of these G1000 airplanes hold 28 volts really steadily, and if I throttle back, even without a lot of load on, below 1000 RPM, the alternator is still struggling a bit. And that leads me possibly to think that we've also got a problem in the alternator. It may even be that the alternator's output is weak and that the master switch has been getting a bit hot because it's been supplying the full 2.5 amps to the field all the time to try and up the output. I don't know, it's possible. We've got more than one fault here, which is not uncommon. But anyway, I'm going to get my scope meter and just see if we can see anything up with the output from this alternator. Occasionally you get a diode gone, and yeah, it confuses the controller and it will cause the output to be slightly weak, even though it will work. So let's have a look at that. All right, we're going to give this a go. I've got my scope meter hooked up, grounded on a seat rail there, and the other wire is clipped onto electrical bus one, which has got a pretty good connection to the alternator. There are some weird things on these G1000 Cessnas. The buses are linked and protected by diodes for a sort of isolation of one bus from another in the event of a big meltdown or short out. You can get some weird effects, but they're not, they're pretty good. They're checked every year. The
essential bus and crossfeed diodes. This alternator field breaker has not tripped. Now they use a weird alternator controller on these. Well, not weird, it's an alternator controller. If it senses overvoltage, it immediately shorts the field to ground, which will kill the alternator's output much quicker than waiting for this thermal breaker to blow. So you can get a situation we've had before where this breaker was blowing, tripping, and I'm thinking, oh, you know, the field wires chafed through or come adrift or shorted down, or the alternator field winding is shorted down. It turned out to be a faulty controller, thinking it was seeing an overvoltage when it wasn't, and shorting the field down. So that took us a little while to fathom. But they're pretty good generally. Anyway, we're going to connect up the scope meter and give it a go. See what sort of output we get.
Let's measure DC volts first, see if we got a good connection. Let's turn the power on. Okay. What's going on here? Auto. I've either got a bad crown or bad connection to buzz, so let's just deal with that. Alright, I had a bad connection to buzz there. Now, if I turn the power on, 24.8 volts. And now, if I set the inputs to AC coupled, we are filtering out the DC. I need to set AC volts here because it's meaningless. We're filtering out the DC, and it's actually picking up a noise from, I think there's a hidden turn and slip that runs behind these G1000s to drive the autopilot. So if it's got the old, it's got the old Cat 140 autopilot, we're getting interference from the motor on that. So we filtered out all the DC. If I put in to AC volts there we go, 9 millivolts.
Right, so I ran the aeroplane again and completely failed to capture the scope trace. For some reason I turned the camera off. Okay, luckily I was able to save and print the scope trace because I patently failed to film it, and I need to set a clock on my scope meter because that says 25th of 6/16. It was actually recorded yesterday, 25th of April, 22. Now, that voltage there, bear in mind that's the AC volts measured with an AC coupled input, 500 millivolts per division and 1 millisecond per division on the time base. That is not a nice healthy shape, and half a volt of ripple voltage, in this system is a lot, because it's connected to a substantial lead acid battery that can easily absorb ripple current and is trying to hold the voltage at a steady, 26, 27 volts nominal. So to see a half a volt of spiky ripple like that does actually indicate possibly a diode failure in the alternator, and I think we should have a look at it. And that's where we started this video, with the alternator on the bench.
All right, knowing what we know now, I think it's time we just had a little bit of a post-mortem on this alternator. Now, it has got to go back for exchange, so I don't want to destroy it, but we can just pop it in bits. See if we can't learn something. These are the six diodes, at least one of which we now suspect as being unserviceable or unsoldered or come away from its associated winding. So we'll give it a little look and see what gives.
All right, now this is tight. There she goes. Once we get the thing in half, I am really hoping we're going to find something conclusive inside here. So I'll speed this bit up and we'll bring you back when we get inside. Alright, need a little tappy tap tap once we get the bolts out, because I want the stator to stay in the back of the alternator with the diodes and the rotor to come out like that. And now let's have a look.
Deep joy.
Brushes look alright, but let's get you in close and see what we find.
Let's get inside there. The other end of these diodes is soldered. One there, one there. There, there. What have we here? Melted out solder. That one has got hot gone high resistance and ain't gonna be doing nothing, and that is responsible for the spike on our scope. Now, it is nice to find something positive and actual fault when you're dealing with these things, because yeah, it's just what you want to see. We'll reassemble this. We got to use a wire through from the back to get these brushes in. Pop it back together, send it for exchange. But even that one looks like it's melted its solder, but that one has had a total meltdown. Why? I don't know, it's just getting a bit old and long in the tooth. Maybe there was some high resistance there. Maybe they were never soldered properly in the first place. But it is good news to find that. It confirms what we saw on the scope. And it's what we like. Something actually wrong with it, rather than just having to randomly replace bits with an intermittent fault that you know, last bit you fiddled with that made it work, you replace it sometimes when you get something really intermittent. But no, this is good. It's what we want to see.
Right, I've got to reassemble this thing just so we can send it for exchange. Now, you have got to be, this is not for the faint-hearted, getting these brushes back in there. Little holders and feeding a wire through really carefully from the back there. The little leads from the brushes have to be rooted perfectly in the slots in the holders. You mustn't stab them with your wire. You need little tools and fiddly fingers to get them in. And then reassembly is the reverse of the removal. But as I said, it is not for the faint-hearted. You've got to be right careful doing this. So I'm only assembling this one for exchange, for overhaul. But it clicked back together nicely there. Pull out the wire, and if you hear two clicks, that's both brushes just snapping against the slip rings. And then back together. Right, like I said, pleased we found something. Feel justified in changing the alternator. We'll pop a new one on tomorrow, but I'm confident that that is going to cure the problem. Thanks for watching. If you like this kind of video, please like, share and subscribe. Good night.